everyone, and welcome back to the Health Peers podcast called Let's Talko About Nutrition. For those of you who may not be familiar with us yet, the Health Peers do a wide range of outreaches on a number of topics related to nutrition, active living, mental well-being, sexual health, and more. We are excited to welcome you to today's podcast. However, before we begin, we do want to respectfully acknowledge that we are recording today from the unceded traditional lands of the Coast Salish peoples, which include the Tsleil-Waututh, Kwikwetlem, Squamish, and Musqueam nations. Now, I'd like to introduce myself and my fellow health peers and co-hosts who will be with us today. My name is Adriana, and I'm joined by both Anna and Jessica. Today, we'll be talking about body acceptance, a topic that I'm sure many of us have had experiences with. We will be diving into conversations around the juxtaposition between body positivity versus body acceptance, the influence of social media, and the practice of intuitive eating. We also wanted to quickly mention to stay tuned for our next podcast, where we will be talking about disordered eating habits, what they are, how to spot the signs, and where to go for help. For both of these podcast episodes, we will be using resources and references from the National Eating Disorder Information Center, also called NEDIC, a nonprofit group based out of the University Health Network in Toronto, Ontario. All of us health peers had the opportunity to attend a workshop hosted by a NEDIC staff member, and we are grateful for the chance to share some of what we learned with all of you today. We'll be linking their resources in the description box of this video, which can provide further information for topics discussed in this podcast. With all of that said, let's get into it and talko about body acceptance. To me, in my own life and experience, body acceptance means that I'm meeting myself where I am at. It can be so easy to focus on what I see as negative or the things I want to change. Yet it can also be tiring to think positively about my own body all the time. I think body acceptance is useful to think about because it allows me to recognize my body for what it can do without the focus or pressure of trying to change it. And in our current climate, it seems that we're all striving for this image of what we think we have to look like. But how about both of you? Maybe we can start with Anna. What does body acceptance mean to you?
Hi, everyone. My name is Anna. So for me personally, I like to also think about all the things that my body does for me rather than just about how it looks. It can be tough to be completely confident in our bodies all the time, but I found that it's easier to accept my body when I think about what it does as well. I can appreciate how it carries me through the day, how strong it is, and that makes me want to properly take care of my body. For me, this means eating nutritious foods, getting exercise, and getting enough rest. What about you, Jessica?
Hi, everyone. My name is Jessica, and I agree with you, Anna. I think that it's extremely important to channel gratitude for our bodies and think of all the amazing things it does on a daily basis to keep us alive. Body acceptance to me means to accept the body I'm in and not to necessarily always have to be happy about it. This means treating our bodies with respect, understanding, and care, and also acknowledging our insecurities and leaving room for our frustrations.
Great. Thank you both for your thoughts and experiences. And now we're just going to move into a more formal understanding of what body acceptance is. So it's the idea of reframing our thoughts around our weight, shape, and looks to be more accepting of ourselves and the bodies we exist in. It can mean figuring out what our bodies need in order to feel good, and finding ways to move that bring us joy. Body acceptance is not linear. It exists on a continuum, and it comes with knowing that some days are going to be harder than others. It's also about recognizing that it's normal and okay to feel this way. It's important to distinguish between body acceptance and body positivity so we can use these two terms appropriately, as they both have different meanings. There are certain expectations and pressures that may be associated with body positivity, and it can feel as though the body positive movement requires us to be constantly happy and positive about all aspects of our body all the time, which is often unrealistic to expect. Shifting the focus from positive to accepting takes us away from what our bodies look like to what our bodies can do, and our bodies can do some pretty incredible things. Also, we wanted to touch on the importance of body diversity. Embracing body diversity means celebrating the differences in our bodies that make each of us unique. Our culture often rejects bodies that are different from the idealized standard and perpetuates this focus that anything outside of what is considered mainstream therefore needs to be changed. And one quote that was impactful and was shared in the NEDIC workshop reads, "It's not our bodies that need changing, it's our attitudes." And I think this is so important to recognize. One example of how we can practice this could be to follow more diverse bodies on social media, so we get an accurate representation of the diversity that actually exists in real life. And this brings us to our next topic on social media and its influence on unrealistic expectations. So I'll pass it on to Jessica.
So with social media being such a big part of our world today, we're constantly saturated with a stream of media and societal pressures related to body image. In turn, this has created a world that makes people believe their self-worth is solely based on their outward appearance. And a common way that social media can hinder body acceptance is through videos that promote a certain lifestyle. For example, what I eat in a day and body transformation videos can create a toxic expectation that we must always eat this way or this is how we should look. And although the intention behind these videos may be good, sometimes the meaning behind these videos can get distorted and end up causing more harm. For example, people may assume that what I eat in a day video implies that this is a specific diet that we must follow in order to have what social media deems is a quote, perfect body. Body transformation videos, it may give off the impression that we need to change how our body looks in order to be accepted in society and feel beautiful in our own skin. I think it's very important to acknowledge what works for one person may not work for another, and it's best to develop a lifestyle that works for you because everyone is different. And continuing on the topic of social media and body image, now I'll cover how that relates to unrealistic expectations. Firstly, how does the media affect body image negatively? Social media influencers, celebrities, TVs, movies, magazines, and the internet all bombard people with images and pressures about what their bodies should look like. And the problem with these versions of beauty are not attainable because they aren't realistic. The majority of images are airbrushed versions of models that have been photoshopped to fit societal or Eurocentric standards of beauty. We're often surrounded by these expectations and aren't even aware of the effects it can create. The media's effect on body image can make people cave into these societal standards and resort to unhealthy measures to try to fit themselves and into this impossible mold. And this can create long-term effects such as disordered eating habits, drug and alcohol use, or even self-harm. So now you're probably wondering, what are some ways I can avoid constantly surrounding myself with these toxic expectations and societal pressures? Luckily, when it comes to social media, the good thing is that we have the power to choose what we can and cannot see. So the first step you can take to create this autonomy is unfollowing triggering social media accounts that you may feel are putting you in a negative mindset. Likewise, with surrounding yourself with positive people in real life, it's equally important to have this positive outlet when going on social media. So my question for the health peers is, what are some ways you develop your own autonomy when it comes to creating a positive space through social media? We could start off with Adriana.
Thanks, Jessica. Yeah, I think it's important to reiterate what you said, that we have autonomy over what we view on our Instagram or other social media feeds. And it's great to follow accounts that are representative of different body types. But also something that I'm working on is not opening up Instagram as soon as I wake up, so I don't start off my day being bombarded by images of what social media thinks is a perfect look and then feeling bad about all the ways that I don't think that I measure up to that standard. So taking these two steps, I'm finding have been positive changes. But what about you, Anna?
So as both Jessica and Adriana mentioned, I think it's good to unfollow accounts that may be negatively impacting you. Sometimes I find that I see people's content constantly, but it's not really making me feel great, or it's just taking up space and time from the accounts that I really do like. So I've recently become a bit of an unfollower. I also like to take breaks from social media. Sometimes I delete an app for a few days at a time, or even just putting my phone in another room for a few hours. This often really helps with my mood and my confidence as well. So finally, I'm going to talk a little bit about intuitive eating. This has been a bit of a buzzword, or buzz phrase, I guess, that people have been using a lot lately. So what is intuitive eating? I've also heard some people refer to it as instinctive eating. Your body naturally tells you when you're hungry, when you're full. You shouldn't have to be constantly thinking about what or when you will next eat. You're just going to eat when your body tells you that it needs food. So this is not a tool for weight loss or for weight gain, which I think is important to note. Your weight may change or it may stay pretty constant, but the point of intuitive eating is about feeling good, not about seeing a specific number on the scale. It's also important to note that intuitive eating may not be for everybody. For example, if you're coming from a past of disordered eating. So we're also going to link the NETIC website down below, which is a great resource to visit. There are 10 principles of intuitive eating at intuitiveeating.org that I did some research on. I'm not going to read them all out to you, but to summarize, it's about respecting your body, respecting your health, rejecting diet mentality and the guilt that you might have surrounding food, and starting to become familiar with your body and with your hunger signals. So as I mentioned above, when done properly, intuitive eating doesn't require you to be constantly thinking about food. This can leave some more time and freedom in your day to do other things or to cope with stress in other ways. For example, I love to go for walks with friends and stop and get a coffee or some treats while we're out. I almost always feel better afterwards because I love getting exercise, I love good conversation, but I'm also not worrying about what I might be eating and thinking that it might be too high in calories or anything like that. So as a quick little discussion question, what are some ways that you guys honor how you're feeling without using food? Jessica, did you want to start?
Yeah, that's a great question. I really like the ideas you mentioned earlier about finding ways to comfort and nurture your feelings without constantly thinking about food. I personally like to practice honoring my feelings with some of my favorite self-care activities, such as spending time in nature, going on walks around my neighborhood, or doing creative projects to express my feelings, like painting or coloring. And what about you, Adriana?
Well, I like to try to get out for a walk every day if I can. I find it both peaceful and refreshing to be outside and take some time that's just myself. I think it's important to create moments in our days to do things that bring us joy, and my walks are definitely one way that I practice this. So with all of that, this concludes our episode for today about body acceptance. We hope you found this episode helpful and now know a little bit more about the difference between body acceptance and body positivity, the influence of social media, and how you can practice intuitive eating. We'd love to hear your thoughts and opinions, so please leave a comment down below if you have any advice, resources, or questions about body acceptance. Again, stay tuned for our next episode on disordered eating habits to learn more about this topic. Also, please be sure to check out the description box for links to the NETIC website, SFU Health and Counseling resources, and any links to any other resources that we may have mentioned in this podcast. Thanks again for listening. Stay safe and healthy, and see you next time. Bye.